Good afternoon, and welcome to our presentation titled The Americanization of the Philadelphia German Reformed Community in the Era of the Revolution. I would like to introduce our presenter, the Reverend Dr. Donald Harpster. But before we begin, I would like to just give a little bit of a background on Reverend Harpster. His hometown was the village of Pine Grove Mills, located near State College, Pennsylvania, and he grew up in the Evangelical and Reformed congregation in Pine Grove Mills. His mother was a pianist, and he was confirmed in 1957 and has always thought of himself as a son of the United Church of Christ. He received his PhD in history from the Pennsylvania State University in 1976 and his Master of Divinity degree from Yale University in 1972. He was ordained as a minister in the United Church of Christ. He served various congregations in Pennsylvania, Maine, and Vermont. From 1990 to 2012, he was a professor of history and political science at the College of St. Joseph in Rutland, Vermont. During those years, he ultimately became the chairperson of the Arts and Science Division. His teaching and research interests included United States history until 1865, American church history, and the American presidency. He also served as the educational coordinator for the Calvin Coolidge Memorial Foundation in Plymouth, Vermont. He is currently retired and is residing in Durham, North Carolina. And without further ado, I will turn this over to Reverend Dr. Donald Harpster to begin our presentation.
What you have in front of you is a timeline. And of course, the title of my presentation is The Americanization of the Philadelphia German Reformed Community in the Era of Revolution, 1775 to 1801. And the full article on this subject appeared in Pennsylvania History, a journal of Mid-American Studies, this year in January. So that's another place that you can access some more material along the way. Next slide, please. How old is the Reformed Church, the German Reformed? Well, goes back to the latter part of the Protestant Reformation and the Palatinate Church Order in 1563. Under Electric Frederick III, the Reform became the established or the official religion of the state. And of course, there were that changed over time back and forth, but that's how it began. He commissioned Caspar Weyberg and Zacharias Ursinus to write the Heidelberg Catechism, which provided the orthodox statement of belief. And the church order also involved the Palatinate Liturgy, which was the standard for worship. Next slide. Now, when I was in confirmation, what was it, probably seventh, eighth grade, something like that, my confirmation was what we used. What did I know back then about the Heidelberg Catechism? Zero, quite frankly, except a few mentions in that particular volume. And it's an intriguing creed. It begins, I would argue, unlike any other. What is your only comfort in life and in death? I kind of see that as an invitation to participate. And the answer that one quite often memorized when you were a member of the Reformed Church, that I belong body and soul in life and death, not to myself, but to my faithful Savior Jesus, who at the cost of his own blood has fully paid for all my sins and has completely freed me from the dominion of the devil. That he protects me so well that without the will of my Father in heaven, not a hair can fall from my head. Indeed, that everything must fit his purposes for my salvation. Therefore, by his Holy Spirit, he also assures me of eternal life, makes me wholeheartedly willing, and ready from now on to live for him. Some comments about that first question. The emphasis on comfort. I mean, I've looked at a whole bunch of other creeds during the Reformation, and it's kind of, most of them are a series of beliefs. This kind of statement is radically different. An existential affirmation that we belong to our Savior Jesus Christ, an emphasis on freedom amid all the troubles that we face in life, including death itself. Trinitarian, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And I like the ending of the first, of the answer of the first question. What it's saying to me is we serve God joyously with a good heart and without restraint. Next, please. William Penn's liberal view on religious toleration encouraged a number of different groups to come to Pennsylvania. It was the most liberal colony as far as religious pluralism was concerned. Guaranteed freedom of worship to all who believed in Almighty God. And secondly, the right to hold office to all who believed in Jesus Christ. Now, you have to be a little careful because in the beginning, if you were Jewish or if you were Roman Catholic, well, the freedom was there, but how would I put it? Not always practiced in the opening years. Pennsylvania and its capital, Philadelphia, was a haven for all types of diverse religious groups. Next, please. The Philadelphia German Reformed Church really began under the Reverend George Michael Wise, who founded the congregation in 1727. First church building was an octagonal structure in 1747. And you'll notice in this slide, it was torn down in 1772 to build a larger church building. Next, please. Who was the pastor during the latter part of the 18th century, the most significant pastor? It was Caspar D. Weyberg, 1763 to 1790. His call came in October 25th of 1763, and it was under his leadership that the congregation achieved stability. There were two major schisms shortly before that period. One involved Michael Schlatter, and the other, his opponent was a former pastor of the church as well, John Conrad Steiner. And in terms of people they were able to minister to, it was about equal. Each of them over 100 different groups. The number of church families rose from 125 in 1765 to 300 in 1772. And that level remained stable throughout the early years of the American Revolution. And it served the Philadelphia German Reformed community until his death in 1790. Oh, I should mention also the other schism. Again, a former pastor, Rothenbühler. And shortly after he started, the congregation really didn't seem to relate to him too well. So he was basically fired. He still stayed around in Philadelphia. And the group that followed him started building a church. If you want to view that church today, in its completed form, it's St. George's United Methodist Church, which is the oldest Methodist church under continuous use during this period. And the problem that the Rothenbühler group had was They got the walls up. That was fine. But then they ran out of money. And back in the 18th century, if you took loans for things, you know, you were expected to pay it back, obviously. And the other problem was that if you didn't, you could end up in debtor's prison. Well, that's basically what happened to the trustees of the Rothenbühler group. There's a story about some people passing by the local jail, and they see some friends in there of the Rothenbühler group and said, "Why are you in here?" And they said, "For building a church." Eventually they sold that then to the Methodists. Next slide. Church-state relations. Well, there were two factors that really helped the Reformed Church in Philadelphia. One was the lease of a graveyard about two blocks from the 4th and Ray Street building, and a charter of incorporation. Both were indications of state support for the religious enterprise, and two examples of how the Philadelphia German Reform adapted to the American environment. Next, please. The German Reformed burial ground was created by essentially Thomas Penn, who was the acting governor of the Pennsylvania, and granted a church lease for the northeast corner of Franklin Square to use as a graveyard on June 8, 1741. And this is the map that you see in front of you is from an architectural study done a few years ago. And if you notice, the Reformed Church back burial ground is in the upper right-hand corner. And it was added on to as time went by. And again, only two blocks from the Ray Street Church. Well, things were fine until the 1790s. And then the city sued the church for a return to the land. And litigation on this one lasted from 1797 until 1836, when the Pennsylvania Supreme Court declared that the grant and subsequent leases were illegal by virtue of Thomas Holmes' original plan for the city in 1682. However, I would argue that the grant indicated state support for the church in the 18th century. Next slide. Even more important was the Charter of Incorporation. It was granted by Governor John Penn in 1765. The other thing I would add is the Lutheran Church at that time and the Reformed Church both got charters of incorporation in September of 1765. In fact, the same day. The Reformed Charter included a provision for erecting and supporting one church more. The governor subsequently included the right to take subscriptions for charitable purposes in Pennsylvania and in Europe. I noticed also that Philadelphia Anglican, Presbyterians, and Lutherans participated in the fundraising, which says something about how they reformed or received during that period. New church edifice was dedicated on Ray Street, May 1st and 2nd of 1774. I've seen various things about how large it was. It was certainly one of the largest buildings in the city of Philadelphia. I've seen some people refer to as the second largest building. And Weyberg, in his report to the Cetus, referred to it having a capacity of 2,000 people. That might be a little stretch, but anyway, it was quite large. Next slide. Well, the revolution is beginning. There's a colonial form of government, but in July 1776, there was a provincial constitutional convention in Pennsylvania to write a new constitution. On September 17, 1776, at a meeting of clergy and interested parties, Provost William Smith of Philadelphia College indicated that there was no plan at all in the revised constitution concerning charters, privileges, legacies, and other pious causes. The two people that were most active in working up petition to the Constitutional Convention, Henry Melchior Muhlenberg and also Caspar Weyberg. And it read as follows: "And all religious societies and bodies of man hereto united and incorporated for the advancement of virtue and learning, for other pious and charitable purposes, shall be encouraged and protected in the enjoyment, privileges, immunities, and estate, which they were accustomed to enjoy and would have enjoyed under the laws and the former constitution of this state." After conferring with Weyberg, Muhlenberg wrote the petition. And if you go to the Pennsylvania archives, you will note this is exactly the wording that they approved. And, if they would have lost their charters, that would have been a major problem. The Reformed and Lutherans probably would have ended up in debtor's prison again. Next slide, please. This is one that I find particularly fascinating. It's called the Preacher's Appeal. But as you note from the slide, neither Weyberg nor Muhlenberg signed it. It did not go out under their name. Muhlenberg at one point said, "Oh, that's a matter for newspapers, not ministers." The church councils, German Reformed Consistory, the Lutheran Church Council, and also the German officials of the German Society were the three groups that were involved in sending this tract that was requested by the Continental Congress, enlisting the support of Germans in New York and North Carolina. As I say, the names of Weyberg and Muhlenberg aren't there. The head official of the German Society's name is the only one you find on the document. Next slide. What about participation in the American Revolution? Well, I looked and looked and looked to try to find an example of people in the Reform who were disaffected in Philadelphia, meaning they weren't in favor of the American Revolution. There was one gentleman that was a possibility, but I couldn't narrow it down that he was Reformed. To the best of my knowledge, he was probably Lutheran, but I really don't know. So general support for the Patriot cause among the Philadelphia German Reformed and Lutherans. The rebels quartered their militia in the Reformed and Lutheran schoolhouses during the winter of 1776-1777. There's one reference to Weyberg acting as a chaplain for the militia, of particularly Reformed. John Philip Bain. Now, he was a Reformed church elder. He was also the son of the Reverend John Philip Bain of earlier years. This Bain and James Young were elected justices of the peace on February 14th, 1777. In the early years of the Revolution, justices of the peace had extensive powers. As an example, on July 9, 1777, they examined Thomas Patterson on suspicion of being, quote, inimical to to American freedom. And with the power that they would have, two of those justices would have, they could have the authority to put people in jail for short terms of imprisonment or for the duration of the war. Jacob Helzheimer, a reformed consistoryman and breeding of writing stock, found himself a useful place in the 1st Battalion of the City Militia. Helzheimer was responsible for also the care of horses for the Continental Army. And as time went by, when Washington, this is after the Revolution, was spending his time in Philadelphia rather extensively, he didn't have enough space in his stables for the horses that he had. And he used the stables of Helzheimer to house some of his horses. So, and of course, the most famous thing about Helzheimer is that he had a diary, extensive diary. And the other thing that's important is the diary was entirely in English, not German. And says something about how at least the leadership in the church were Americanized early on. Next slide. My favorite character in terms of people that I wrote about was a gentleman by the name of Lewis Farmer. He was a deacon in the church as early as 1771. He was secretary of the Reformed Consistory or Church Council, and he rose to the rank of Lieutenant Colonel in the 13th Pennsylvania Regiment. He wintered with George Washington's army at Valley Forge in the winter of 1777-1778. The 13th Pennsylvania Regiment participated in a whole host of battles, the battles of Long Island and White Plains, the battles of Trenton and Princeton, the battles of Brandywine and Germantown, and the Battle of Monmouth. Lieutenant Colonel Farmer was empowered to, you know, of course, the Battle of Trenton was what? A surprise to the Hessian soldiers that were there, to say the least. A lot of them were captured. And it was Colonel Farmer's responsibility to take those prisoners from Trenton to Philadelphia, where they would be exchanged or maybe put in prison, one of the two. He was wounded in the Battle of Long Island, but still continued service of serving the 13th Regiment. He resigned from the 13th Regiment when it was incorporated into the 2nd Pennsylvania on July 1st, 1778. He returned to his occupation as an innkeeper. He later served as the Army Commissar of Pennsylvania, basically in the quartermaster department. And eventually he rose to the rank of colonel. Next slide, please. Other members who participated in the revolution, there are a number of them, I'll mention three. Jacob Lawlersweiler, Melchior Steiner, and Peter Ozias. Captain Lawlersweiler was the paymaster for the 13th Pennsylvania Regiment. Sergeant Steiner served in Burkhardt's company in the 3rd Regiment of Foot, and Lieutenant Peter Ozias served in the 4th Battalion of the City of Philadelphia Militia. I bring these up because you'll hear more about them as we go. Next slide, please. One thing that I honestly did not know when I wrote the article was the existence of a broadside having the Declaration of Independence translated into German. To the best of our knowledge, that was the first time that the Declaration was translated into the German language. I have the date on the slide, July 5th, 1776. I've seen other sources where it says July 6th, 7th, or 8th. But it's before it appeared in Miller's newspaper. This particular item was on display at the Museum for the American Revolution of Philadelphia this past year. Who created it? The printing house of Melchior Steiner and Charles Sist. Steiner was a member of the Philadelphia German Reformed Church. He was the son of the Reformed minister, John Conrad Steiner. And they printed a number of other things that were essentially supportive of revolutions, including Thomas Paine's Common Sense. Next slide. The British occupation of Philadelphia occurred between September of 1777 and June of 1778. Lord William Howe entered the city as a conqueror, with Joseph Galloway, a Philadelphia loyalist, at his side. On September 26th, 1777. Galloway was one of the people who encouraged Howe to come to Philadelphia. His comment was, there are lots of loyalists there. Don't worry. It'll be a walk in the park. It's also the same time where Washington and his army were at Valley Forge. Lord Howe and his army left Philadelphia by June of 1778. Next slide, please. When I was working on this material, I was surprised at the reaction of the British to Michael Schlatter. You know, Michael Schlatter was at this point retired, living in Chestnut Hill, and British soldiers came and literally plundered his home, burned a lot of his papers, etc. And I thought, you know, that's rather strong action against a member of the clergy. Well, he was the former pastor of the German Reformed Church. He was the one who organized the German Reformed Cetus. And initially, in September of 1777, apparently, Schlatter left Philadelphia, went north to join Howe's army to resume his former position as a chaplain in the British Army. Very quickly changed his mind because some of the members of his family had joined the Patriot cause, in particular, two brothers. He was imprisoned in Philadelphia sometime prior to November 9th, 1777, and was released in early February 1778. One of the problems I had was finding references to Reformed women in the 18th century. I don't know, I kept looking. I found one diary of someone in New Jersey, but that was kind of it. And Rachel, Michael Schlatter's daughter of age 14, however, traveled the 10 miles from Chestnut Hill to Philadelphia on horseback to bring him provisions. Because if you were the British imprisoned you during this time, let's put it this way, did you have enough to eat? No. Did you have a suitable clothing always? No. And so Rachel was the one who ministered to her father during this time. Next slide. Pastor Weyberg course, his services were always in German during the whole period that he was pastor. And, you know, if you're a German Reformed, of the German Reformed faith, and you're a soldier, you might want to go to church on a Sunday morning. Well, Weyberg's church is where they went. And the sermons they would hear Weyberg preach often emphasized the rightness of the rebel cause. The British authorities felt that his appeals might lead to mass desertions. Therefore, they imprisoned him for a brief time between January and mid-February 1778. There's one story or legend about Weyberg's son standing at the door of his father's house and shouted as the British troops passed, "Hooray, General Washington!" The soldiers replied in muttered tones, "You rebel." Now, it's somewhat questionable the authenticity of that account. However, the imprisonment of Schlatter and Weyberg left little doubt about their sympathies. Next slide. The British tore up the interior of the newly completed Ray Street Church, converted into a military hospital, and that happened to a number of other congregations in Philadelphia. I love the text for his first sermon after being liberated. It's from Psalm 79, verse 1. O God, the heathen are come into thine inheritance. Thy holy temple have they defiled. Who are the heathen? The British. Even as late as May of 1779, members were still returning to the city. They were reluctant to come back because they were worried the British might come back again. However, a lot of strangers moved into the city and joined in the life of the congregation, so the membership remained stable. Next slide. You know, Philadelphia was the main port of entry for German immigrants during the 18th century. Some would go to New York, maybe other ports, but Philadelphia was where most entered. And even if you're there, some would go to New York, they would come down to Pennsylvania eventually. Not all of them, but some. The journey of German immigrants was often difficult and did not get any better when they arrived at a port of entry. Now, how were they processed? Well, the first method used was to have people in the mayor's office process the immigrants. And then three justices of the peace assumed responsibility. However, there was no guarantee that those who processed the immigrants really understood what the immigrants were saying. In fact, I suspect most times they did not. The German Society in Philadelphia was started specifically to aid immigrants, German immigrants coming to this country. Well, the Society petitioned the Pennsylvania legislature for change in 1785, and two requirements. The registrar, person in charge, must be a resident of Philadelphia and also be able to speak and write in English and German. Meeting these requirements, Lewis Farmer was the first person to hold that office from 1785 to the early 1790s. Next slide. Four major events occurred in the 1774 or second building for the German Reformed community. A memorial service for Major General Richard Montgomery, February 19th, 1776. A grand concert of sacred music, May 4th, 1786. A memorial service for George Washington on February 22nd, 1800. And one item that, to the best of my knowledge, not too many people know about, a celebration of Thomas Jefferson as President of the United States on March 4th, 1801. I mean, he was sworn in Washington. The Capitol had moved by that time, but the politics had changed a bit. Most of the reform people were Federalists until you get to the 1790s, and then a number became Democratic Republicans or of the party of Jefferson. All four of these events were held in the Philadelphia German Reformed Church, given that it was still one of the largest buildings in Philadelphia. All were indications of the congregation's involvement, deep involvement in the American environment. Next slide. The memorial service for Major General Richard Montgomery, February 19, 1776. It was the Second Continental Congress that requested this memorial service be held. With all of these special services, you get a processional of various dignitaries going to the church. This one started at the State House, included faculty and students of the College of Philadelphia, clergy of Philadelphia, members of the Continental Congress, the General Assembly, the mayor and the corporation, and a whole host of military units. Provost William Smith gave the oration. How would I put it? Big time controversial. He tried to tread a middle path between the restoration of ties with England and open rebellion. Notice the date, February 19th, 1776. By that time, a number of people weren't interested in a middle path. Particularly, John Adams and his friends wanted a complete rupture, which happened in July of 1776. Adams specifically called the oration an insolent performance. There was a push in the Second Continental Congress to publish his remarks. It was voted down because of things. Let's put it this way, he didn't win friends and influence people on that particular occasion. Next slide. This is the one that I wish I could have been there. It's the Grand Concert of Sacred Music, May 4th, 1786. What are we talking about in terms of people who were active in this one? 50 instrumentalists, a choir of 230 members. Let's put it this way. I've never had a church that had anything like that before. Advance sales totaled around 1,000 tickets. There were three instrumentals, five anthems, and one of the anthems was The Rose of Sharon by William Billings of Boston. I looked that up on YouTube. How would I put it? It's not my favorite piece of music, but given who the composer was, I need to listen to this. Because William Billings of Boston was called the first American composer. One of the first renditions in America of the Hallelujah Chorus. The first was at the Anglican Christ Church in Philadelphia. Certainly the concert was equal to any performance in Europe at that time. Next slide. Memorial service for George Washington, February 22nd, 1800. Resolution of the United States Congress on December 30th, 1799. Marked the idea of February 22nd as being a day of national mourning. One of the first celebrations of Washington's birthday is a national holiday. And you notice the slide. This, they're on Market Street, and they're moving toward the German Reformed Church where the celebration was held, or the memorial service. They're probably playing Washington's March at this particular time. The lead horse, which is this one, with the saddle and full military trappings representing the general and president. How would I put it? You don't get a higher class of Americans in the audience than this one. President John Adams, Vice President Thomas Jefferson, members of the Senate and the House of Representatives, and Robert Lister, the British minister. Remember, when this service was held, Philadelphia was still the seat of the American government. They hadn't quite made it to Washington at that point. Next slide. Now this one, again, to best of my knowledge, not too many people know about this particular event. A Democratic Republican Party celebration of the inauguration of Thomas Jefferson as President of the United States, March 4th, 1800. Again, a procession from Independence Hall to the Reformed Church, a reading of the Declaration of Independence, and an oration. Notice notice the nature of the parade. 20 companies of Republican militia, meaning people who subscribe to the Democratic Republican Party, a float that showed a ship named the Thomas Jefferson, and a host of Republican supporters wearing, quote, caps of liberty. Where do you find references of caps of liberty in another country? Think France. Think the French Revolution. The dinner, which followed at another location, attracted approximately 2,000 participants. I couldn't find out where it was, but let's put it this way. The city tavern was not large enough for this party. Next slide. Now, when I first came across Peter Osias and this particular celebration, I get up from my chair, walked out, took a nice walk. I thought, one of the most exciting things I came across. Well, Peter, if you know, this is a picture of the Grand Federal Edifice. It's on a carriage, originally pulled by 10 white horses. 13 columns and 10 are painted, 3 aren't, because 3 states hadn't ratified things up to that point. This was held on July 4th, 1788. It was the centerpiece of the procession. If you look at a newspaper printed as late as as July 4th or 5th, Osias' name is still there. It's on a broadside for the parade. But if you look at the write-up after the event, Osias isn't there. And a prominent Philadelphia merchant by the name of Benjamin Fuller replaced Osias on that day. Do I know why? I have no clue. Now, think about this as being the biggest thing that ever happened in terms of celebrations in Philadelphia up to this point. 5,000 people marched in the procession. There were so many that they came down a number of streets. Market was only one of them. 17,000 sat down to an afternoon dinner at a city park and heard an oration. The most elaborate celebration in Philadelphia until the centennial procession in 1876. Next slide, please. Some conclusions. During the era of the American Revolution and the decades following, the Philadelphia German Reform community played a significant role in the city, in the state, and also in the nation. Location of four important cultural, civic, and political events. Those events wouldn't have happened for the German Reformed in Philadelphia without the institutional stability created by Weyberg, the aid of the state for a graveyard, and a charter of incorporation. As far as I could determine, very supportive of the Patriot cause. However, the American process was not complete. The official language of the Race Street congregation remained German, and the community remained loyal to its theological heritage in the Heidelberg Catechism and its worship in terms of the Palatinate Liturgy. You are welcome to turn yourselves on at this point if you have questions that you might want to ask or comments.
All right, welcome back, everyone. All right, we do have some time for some question and answer. Let me go ahead here. You can either type your questions in the chat box if you want. We did have one, Don, that did come in during the program. So maybe I'll ask that one first to get us started, and then I'll open it up for people to unmute. But the first question we received was, assuming that Lewis Farmer's name was anglicized, there's another sign of how the Reformed German leadership assimilated fairly quickly. Well, I guess that's more of a statement that you might want to respond to than a question.
Well, I kept looking for him in the, you know, those lists of who came over on the boat.
Oh, I think you might have gotten muted somehow.
I'll start again. I look for Lewis Farmer's name on the lists of people who came over on the boat in the 18th century, from 1725 up to, I think about 1770. His name does not appear. What that said to me was that one thing it could be is that he was under the age of 16. If you were under the age of 16, you weren't counted. And only the kind of the heads of family groups, the male head would be counted. Women weren't counted either. There was one person called Ludwig, which would be the German equivalent of Lewis, Ludwig Farmer, but I have the feeling one that's probably somebody else, the other odd thing was that he didn't take the oath to the British king until I think it was 1770, 1771, In 1771, he was a deacon in the church. Well, I don't think you become a deacon of the church back then if you're, you know, under 16 years of age. Usually it's, you know, and it need to be a little older then. In fact, I can remember when I started the ministry, you know, high school students didn't become officers until a few more years, let's put it that way. I didn't agree with that because I thought sometimes they knew more than the older ones, but that's another story. And he was very active in the church. I mean, he was one of the leaders about building the new church. After the revolution, you see him as listed as secretary, all kinds of things. But, you know, the other thing that, remember I mentioned that I really liked the guy? Let me tell you one thing that happened that I didn't put in this presentation. It's in my paper. He was the second in command of a group, I think it was called the Pennsylvania something afoot, okay? And the head colonel, the head honcho, was a guy by the name of John Bull. None of the officers liked Bull at all. In fact, at one point, they wrote up their resignations. They were going to resign from the Continental Army, all of them. They were on their way to submit those to the Pennsylvania Assembly and the Board of War. And Farmer stopped them and said, "Oh, I have some good news for you." "What's that?" "John Bull will no longer be your commander. It will be a man by the name of Colonel Stewart." In fact, Colonel Stewart wants to have a party and you're all invited. And what that said to me was, and by the way, the officers wanted Farmer to be their commander. When he stopped them and made those comments, it said to me he could care more about the integrity of the unit than anything else. And he wasn't really angling to be the commander, although I'm sure he'd have made a good one. That says something about his character, which is rather unusual in some military situations. So that's why I liked him.
Yeah, thank you for expanding on that. Michael, did that address your comment or question?
Yeah, I would just suspect that if you look back under Bauer, which is a really common German surname, it just got translated. I had a seventh great grandfather who founded Reamstown, and they came over as Reams in a German spelling, and in the first generation changed it to R-E-A-M-S to anglicize it. So I think it was fairly common for that generation of Germans to want to look more English.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that suggestion.
Yeah. Yeah. Victoria, you had a question here. This story begins in 1563 with the Palatinate Church order. Reformed does not seem to be a church in modern Germany today. Did the Reformed movement or Reformed Church gain any lasting traction in Germany?
Well, I can't speak for modern day Germany, but it seems to me when you talk about somebody like Philip Schaff, he was Reformed. And one reason that you don't have it is my sense is that the Reformed, and again, I could be wrong, but I thought at some point the Reformed and the Lutherans merged. It's interesting, though, that when I was looking through, you know, it's difficult to find names from church records. You can find the leadership, but there aren't membership lists, okay, along the way. There are communicant lists. And one thing I came across, this was in 1780. It was Baron von Steuben attending the German Reformed Church. Of course, he was the guy that organized Washington's army at Valley Forge, and later, he was a major general, and he was, how would I put it? He was baptized in the Reformed Church in Germany. So that's all. And he later became a, what was it? an elder in a German Reformed church in New York City once he moved there after the war.
If I could,
I'm sure that answers the question completely, but
if I could add something,
sure.
My ancestors are German Reformed, slightly later, coming over in 1850. But the German Reformed Church is still one of the two authorized churches in North Rhine-Westphalia. It is within the Reformed community in Germany. There's a branch that is Lutheran and a branch that is Reformed. And my cousin, who's a pastor, is certified to preach on both sides. But it's, in fact, the Reformed Church, I can't pronounce it in German, Reformation Kirche or something like that, is the, there's Catholic and Reform are the two choices. Or you can opt out of being a churchgoer. If you stay in the church system, either Reform or Catholic, then you pay an annual tax that goes to pay for the that appropriate church. And you can be buried and baptized and married in that church. If you don't pay the tax, then most, at least Reform congregations, and I think also Catholic, would not offer you rights. You're not a paid up taxpayer.
That's interesting that that state support really continued. Because I remember reading some things about, the church that would be dominant would switch. Sometimes it would be Reformed. This is like a couple of centuries. Sometimes it was Reformed, then Lutheran, et cetera. It would go back and forth, But that state tax still being there.
Yeah, the state tax
that's big time.
Directly, the money is channeled directly into the churches. Although it's collected through the state system, none of it, there is no non-church tax money going into the churches. And no, all of the church tax money goes to that church. However, the state does support church work like social services. Many of the state social services are channeled through the churches.
Interesting.
At a contract kind of operation, as is sometimes done here.
Yeah. Thank you. Chuck Maxfield.
Yeah. For many immigrant churches, the biggest transition right away is becoming self-supporting and self-governing, that they no longer have state support. And so they need to raise their own funds, hire their own pastor, pay for their own building and so forth. And I'm wondering, with a confused political situation in the Palatinate, if this was also true for the German Reformed, or if they had already been in the situation of being self-supporting.
Well, I know the Palatinate was, let's say, the time of Schlatter, 18th century, okay? That it was a poor area. That's why the synods of North and South Holland kind of took up the slack, because of their, that was a fairly wealthy area because of the Dutch shipping, et cetera. But aid from the Palatinate was practically nil during that period. I can't answer your specific question. I don't know. I'm not sure about that. Maybe somebody else knows here.
All right. Other questions? We did have one comment in the chat box. Garland Gates, the church to which I belong is Steuben Congregational United Church of Christ in the Crossroads Village of Steuben, Ohio. A number of years ago, one Sunday, I portrayed the Baron. I'm the ENR boy in congregational land. Yes. Right. Yes, and Garland is also a board member for ERHS, a wonderful board member and officer. We talk about that many times. He's the ENR boy at a congregational church, yes. Yeah.
May I tell everybody a story about my family? My ancestors came over 1740s, 1750s to what is now the State College area, Central Pennsylvania. And one of my ancestors, a guy by the name of Jacob Hauser, founded the town of Hauserville outside of State College. He was a private in the military, in a militia group. And he came over with his father, who I believe was Mennonite. But anyway, he settled in Central Pennsylvania. And if you go to State College, there's a road between State College and the county seat of Center County, and it's called the Benner Pike, okay? That refers to Philip Benner. And Philip Benner, to the best of my knowledge, was the richest dude in the area, okay? And he had iron furnaces, okay? What do you need to create the heat to melt the iron so that you can work it? Coal wasn't available there particularly. It's charcoal. Mm-hmm. What do you need if you need charcoal? Extensive woodlands. Well, Mr. Benner had his eye on my ancestors' woodlots and wanted my ancestor to sell it to him. And Jacob said, no way. I'm glad that I'm here, etc. I worked hard for what I have. I'm not going to sell it to you. So what did Mr. Benner do? He got some of his people to find a dead horse and put a dead horse in the woodlot. My ancestor came out, you know, just inspecting his property one day, saw the dead horse. Actually, I don't think he saw the dead horse immediately. What he saw were the crows flying around. My understanding is crows are a sign of death among Germans. He ran away from the woodlot, never went back. My assumption is he sold the property to Mr. Benner. I think of that because I often think of my ancestors as being discriminated against. And that seems to me was a kind of discrimination, if you will, along the way. That's the story.
Interesting. Yeah. Thank you. Chuck, you had your hand up a minute ago. Did you have another question? Oh, I think you might.
Yeah. Okay. I'm thinking about when we think about Americanization, we often think about the language issue, right, which really does not come up in some cases for another half century. And I guess I'm thinking there's kind of three stages to Americanization. First, you have taking the Patriot side in the Revolution, which was in effect a civil war. And secondly, you have the Declaration of Independence from the Netherlands and establishing their own synod. And thirdly, the transition in language, which comes much later. I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on why it took them so long to transition the language after the revolution.
Well, now this is a comment from the early 19th century when the language question was big time. Mm-hmm. And you had splits in the congregation, some English, some German. Yeah. I remember looking through the archives of Old First Church years ago, and they had various letters. One was by Samuel Helfenstein, who was the pastor there for like, what, 30, about around 30 years during the language controversy. And in the letter, he says specifically that he firmly believed that God speaks in Hochdeutsch, High German. Well, I think of Weyberg. He was not comfortable with the English language. Some of his members were. And I think they were comfortable partly because of business dealings they would have. Hiltzheimer, for example, was one. Lawlersweiler was the, well, there's an organization, Guardians of the Poor. He was the secretary of that organization. And that crosses people who speak English, German, et cetera. And it would be difficult to be the secretary unless you understood English and were able to speak it as well. Farmer was fluent in English. Almost from, I sense early on. And if you talk about Steiner, my understanding with that translation into German, Steiner and Sist were the ones who did the translating of that document. And again, to translate a document into another language means that you need to have some knowledge early on. Those were significant leaders during that period. But it's a gradual thing, as you indicated. The language question really didn't come to the fore until the early 19th century.
Yeah.
And what put a kibosh on it completely, my feeling is, revivalism. What put a kibosh on the language issue was revivalism. One of the people that the, not just the German Reform, but other groups in Philadelphia wanted to come to Philadelphia was Charles G. Finney. And he conducted a revival in the 1820s. And once he was there, even adherence to the old Heidelberg Catechism was less among the membership.
If I could add something.
Yeah, go ahead.
This is the Eastern form of the German Reform. My interest is in the Western part. My great-grandfather came over, Peter Witz, in 1853 as a missionary. He had a call to be a missionary to the Germans in Ohio and Wisconsin. And he went to Heidelberg University. And he founded or was the initial pastor at a whole series of congregations on the Ohio-Indiana border, all of which spoke German. And in all of these small towns in Ohio, there were often they were all German speaking. Where my father grew up, New Bremen, Ohio, was the Protestant town. 3 miles away was Minster, Ohio, which was Catholic German. But the German language was taught in the Cincinnati public schools up until World War I. And World War I basically forced the German-speaking churches to switch to English, although my great-grandfather was the one who came over, but my grandfather, who spoke German as his first language, he preached in German until the 1930s. Once a month, the congregation in Cincinnati would have a German service, and he preached that service. My great uncle was the English pastor, and he lived there and did the German service. But even as in the probably 1910, 1915, the Germans in Cleveland were pushing for German language books in the libraries. German was still quite common as we might think of as Italian in Italian neighborhoods in New York, up until really the First World War, when many Germans had changed their names and had to de-Germanize because of the great prejudice against Germans raised by the First World War.
Yeah, we saw some, you know, in thinking about the groups that formed the ENR, you know, we see these generational shifts in the language. The German Reformed Church, which was much older than the Evangelical Synod of North America on the east side, gave up the German much earlier in 1863, and they actually dropped the German from their name and changed to the Reformed Church in the United States. The Evangelical Synod of North America, which really was organized officially in 1840, they continued in German almost until about 1929 or so, especially in their publications. And then when we look at our Hungarian Reformed Church that was organized in 1890, many of them are still continuing in Hungarian today. So we kind of see like this 100-year mark of these generational shifts with the language. Certainly World War I and World War II dramatically changed the language piece as well. But it's an interesting piece to think about. Yes, Reverend Betsy.
Yeah, just a comment on that it might have been official changes, but in terms of practice, it was very much still in place. One of the churches that Don served, the church where I grew up, St. John's in Shamokin, Pennsylvania, had a pastor from 1890 to 1930, Reverend Dr. Schneider, and he wrote out his manuscripts for services in German script, and was still doing German language services, you know, well into his pastorate. So I think that even when the official pieces were coming across, the local practices were still very much tied to what people were looking for, and what could provide for the community that was there.
Yeah, good point. Very good point. Other questions? Okay, we did have, looks like, comment here from Nancy Donahue. In the early 19th century, Old First had two episodes of people leaving the church over the language issue. First, those who wanted to switch to English left. Later, those who preferred worshiping in German left. When English finally won out, the minutes of the church switched immediately from German to English. Yeah, it's interesting. Okay, anything else to wrap up? Any comments, questions? All right, well, Reverend Harpster, I am so honored that ERHS was able to help facilitate this and share this information with everyone who is here today. We did record this session, so we will make it available to those of you that were with us today and to hopefully others that were not able to make it with us today. So I certainly appreciate all of you for being here. Later today, I will send out some additional information to everyone who registered, a short survey on the presentation. And I will also send out a copy of the recording, as well as some additional programs that are coming up from the Evangelical and Reformed Historical Society. And of course, ways that you can help give your time, talents, and treasures to the society so that we can keep these programs and this work going into the future. We certainly would appreciate that as well. So I appreciate all of you for taking about this hour and a half on your Tuesday afternoon, and wish all of you well and look forward to seeing you at future programs in the future.
Thank you, everyone. I enjoyed this a great deal.
Good, thank
you. From Pasadena, California.
Great, well, it's afternoon for you there?
Morning.
Morning. Okay. Yes. All right. Well, thank you for sharing your morning with us.
Right.
Well, take care, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you again.
Bye-bye. Thank you, everybody.